morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this meeting of the Executive Subcommittee of the Lifelong Learning Committee. Great to see our head teachers and acting head teachers and quality improvement officers, and we look forward to hearing what you've all got to say. We don't have any apologies or substitutions for today. Do we have any declarations of interest from elected members? None. Can we approve the minute of the meeting of the Exec Sub of 29th of October 2018? And that takes us straight into the papers before us today. Before we start, it would be helpful if we could just go round and you could just all say who you are and your job, just for us so that we can hopefully get names and faces correct.
Roger Hill, Head of Secondary and Inclusion.
Sharon Johnston, Head of Early Years and Primary. Bernadette Scott, Service Manager of Early Learning and Childcare.
Kim Ramsey, Quality Improvement Officer for Early Years and Primary.
Jo White, Acting Head Teacher at Lethem.
Donald McLeod, Quality Improvement Officer for Secondary Education.
Thursa Pupillo, Head Teacher at Perth High School.
Pauline Smith, Head Teacher, Kinross Primary School.
Gillian Knox, Quality Improvement Officer, Early Years and Primary.
James Charles, Performance Officer.
That's great, thank you very much. I'm now going to ask Sharon Johnson to introduce the papers.
Thank you, Convener. This report sets out the key findings following inspection of preschool centres and schools undertaken by Education Scotland and, by exception, the Care Inspectorate, on the inspections of daycare of children since the Executive Subcommittee of Lifelong Learning since the 29th of October 2018. This report includes details of the joint inspection of Lethem Primary School and Nursery Class and the Education Scotland inspections of Perth High School and Kinross Primary School and Nursery Class. The Care Inspectorate inspections of Methven Primary School Nursery, Bridge of Erne Nursery, Oakbank Kids Club and Honeypot Children's Nursery, Almond Bank, are also included as they received one or more excellent gradings. Section 3 of the report sets out our performance summary, and an overall grading of the quality indicators is set out on page 11 of this report, and a full appendix of all of the inspections that have been undertaken with their quality improvement indicators are on pages 57 and 58 of this report. Happy to take questions on that.
Thank you, Sharon. Do we have any questions for Sharon? No. So we can just move straight on. Sharon, thank you.
I'd like to introduce the first paper, which is the inspection of Lethem Primary School. In September 2018, Lethem Primary School was inspected by a team of inspectors from both Education Scotland and the Care Inspectorate. The evaluations from Education Scotland are contained on page 18 of the report, and the gradings from the Care Inspectorate for the nursery are on page 19. As can be seen from the evaluations from both agencies, only two of the eight quality indicators meet the criteria that Perth and Kinross Council have set itself of good or better, and only two of the four Care Inspectorate gradings received those gradings. Whilst these evaluations fall below our expectations, it should be noted that the school improvement team had already conducted a number of reviews within the school which had identified the same strengths and areas for development prior to the formal inspection. And we had been working with the school on an action plan prior to the formal inspection. PKC quality improvement staff recognised that the strengths of the school lay in their commitment to the care and well-being of the children and families and strong partnership working. We had also identified the urgent need to improve attainment and achievement and also learning and teaching approaches. We therefore welcomed this inspection report and have continued to work with the school on their improvement agenda. Education Scotland and the Care Inspectorate will return to the school for a follow-up visit towards the end of this year to inspect progress, and we will continue to work with Education Scotland, Care Inspectorate and the school throughout this process. Kim Ramsey is the Quality Improvement Officer for the school, and I'll ask her to provide an overview of the report and to introduce Jo White, the Acting Head Teacher for the school, to talk through the action plan and progress to date.
What I'd like to do is just to talk through the strengths that were identified by Education Scotland and the Care Inspectorate. So the inspection team found, following strengths, the commitment of the head teacher and deputy head teacher and the staff team across the school in improving the well-being of children and families in a supportive, caring and nurturing environment. The highly effective partnership working with the range of colleagues to secure the best possible outcomes for children and families, and the children who presented themselves as being polite and friendly and very proud of their school. So what I'd like to do is to hand over to Mrs. Jo White, who is acting head teacher at the moment, who will talk you through the improvement priorities which were identified and also the plans which have been in place for some time and progress up to date. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to take you through the four key improvement agendas as identified by our HMI inspection. I'm going to kind of talk you through what we've done so far and kind of what we've identified still as our ongoing next steps. So firstly, ensuring consistent learning and teaching across the school, which will lead to children being stretched and supported in their learning where they need to be. So that was one of the key improvement areas. So in terms of what we've done so far, we've worked really, really closely as a staff team to ensure that we've got that shared vision of what does high quality learning and teaching look like here at Lethem. What does it sound like? What does it feel like for our children? At the moment, children have been involved in creating a kind of a shared vision of this by what does a good learner look like, sound like and feel like at Lethem. And we're in the process of creating kind of a standard which will be displayed throughout our school for us to be working towards. We've also worked really closely together to plan high quality learning experiences, making sure that we've all got the same high aspirations and same high expectations for our children. And we've built time in our collegiate calendar for teaching staff, support staff and early years staff to work really closely together with planning. Our annual and medium-term planning across the school and nursery has also been reviewed to ensure it's absolutely fit for purpose. A key area which we have been working on is supporting our children to be much more able to talk about their learning. So really clear as to why they're learning what they're learning, how they're going to know that they're going that they've been successful. And embedding this language has been a real focus for staff training sessions. And we've been well supported by Kirsty Harker, Education Support Officer for Perth Kinross Council. We've been monitoring the impact of this through use of Seesaw, which is our new digital profiling tool, classroom observations and learning conversations, which we're really pleased to have already identified an increase in the number of children who are much more articulate about their learning. We're also supporting parents to hold these learning conversations at home through stay and learn sessions. And most recently, parents have been given helpful fridge magnets with a few key learning questions to support these conversations at home on a daily basis. To really ensure consistency in learning and teaching requires really robust quality assurance, as we know. So we've reviewed, as a management team, our calendar of planned opportunities to be undertaking formal observations, to be undertaking evidence of learning, walks, and so on. So we've increased these and are sort of sifting through the data and identifying the next steps which that's telling us. So in terms of the consistency in learning and teaching, our next steps still are to absolutely reach that shared standard of excellent learning and teaching for Lethem that all staff, children, parents and our stakeholders aim for. We will be working to ensure that staff are using questioning skillfully to enable children to think for themselves, to build their curiosity and to ask questions. We'll be ensuring consistency in the use of digital technologies and programmes to promote learning and raise attainment further, upskilling staff and thinking about the impact of particular resources. And we'll also be supporting children to develop their skills for life, learning and work with a particular focus on pupil leadership. In terms of our second area of improvement, we absolutely are aiming for our learners to reach the expected standards in literacy and numeracy. So what we've done already, we've worked with teaching staff and early years staff to develop confidence in making those sound judgments about achievement of a level, and staff across the school are engaging more with the benchmarks to do so across the curriculum. We continue to promote an ethos of high expectations for our children and to support children to have these for themselves. We've reviewed our timetables to ensure that we're absolutely maximising learning and teaching time within the classrooms. And we absolutely know that we have a number of learners who do require additional supports to achieve national standards. We have a number of interventions in place. We have a really skilled team of support staff who support our children with additional support needs. The number of interventions we're doing have been streamlined to ensure that we're not doing too much and only what matters, and that we can absolutely assess the impact that they're having. In terms of our next steps in raising attainment, we have to still refresh our whole school approach to writing. Writing is a key area for us where we absolutely need to raise attainment further. We'll be continuing to use assessment data to assess pupil which we are undertaking, and working really closely with parents. We have a really supportive parent body and have already been working really closely alongside our parent council to identify ways in which parents can support us to raise attainment further. Part of that will be looking at reviewing our home learning, considering ways we can support children, make sure they're ready for learning, ensuring positive sleep, healthy breakfast and snacks and so on. Our third priority was around making our curriculum more appropriate to Lethem and its learners. We've done a significant amount of work on this since the inspection, and as Sharon had said prior to the inspection, we're really proud to work in the Lethem community and need to make sure that we're focusing on what our children need and what's relevant to them. So our curriculum rationale has been reviewed with input from pupils, staff and parents. Staff now have plans to work from to ensure children are experiencing a really broad curriculum and to ensure that it's progressive. So using stepping stones which are taking the child on a journey. These plans are really supporting staff to know the next steps in learning and to ensure that we're challenging our learners, moving children on at an appropriate pace and ensuring coverage of other curricular areas. Our next steps in terms of this are we need to ensure that we're sharing our rationale widely, and we're continuing to use this to plan learning, to ongoingly review that our curriculum remains fit for purpose, and in nursery, giving more ownership to our early years practitioners to lead on specific curricular areas. Finally, we want to ensure that we're giving our learners the very best start by building strong foundations in literacy and numeracy skills. What have we done so far? We have been fortunate to appoint a centre leader for our nursery who is working as part of the management team to lead on the improvement agenda. Our early years curriculum has been a real focus, and we've developed this along with timetables to ensure a focus on literacy and numeracy learning experiences and to ensure that play opportunities are well planned. Staff in the early years are meeting weekly to jointly plan to ensure progression and consistency across the early years. We've been using fluid groupings to ensure the needs of all are being met and that we're providing pace and challenge for our learners to progress. And we've been using an active approach where children carousel learning activities, and this has been really well supported by our acting deputy through PEF, our PT literacy through PEF, class teachers and an early years practitioner. We've worked significantly hard to improve our nursery and early years environment to become more literacy and numeracy rich, and we're seeing the benefits of that with increased pupil engagement and planned learning opportunities and activities. Staff have also been fortunate enough, and we've been well supported by the Perth and Kinross Council to allow us to undertake good practice visits to other settings to gather ideas and then embed these back in our own setting. We already had in place a robust tracking system for the primary school. This has now been introduced in the nursery for individuals, groups and across the stage. Our ECPs have been trained in high quality observations and supporting their children with their next steps in learning. And Seesaw has also been implemented in nursery to support the link with learning at home and to develop parental engagement further. Our next steps in this aspect are to support practitioners to develop well-planned play experiences, model use of effective observation and interactions, and prepare preschool children to be school ready. We were really pleased with an area of good practice which has been identified in our inspection report, which was the commitment of the school to improving the health and well-being of children, families and the community by organising and leading our summer club, which was open to all families with children living in the community. Over 1,000 children and young people accessed free school lunches throughout the summer holidays last session and participated in a wide range of activities, receiving a hot meal. Families benefited nutritionally, financially, and through a reduction in social isolation. And we're really proud that this model is in the process of being replicated across the authority.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jo. That's the worst bit over now, I think. Just picking up your final point, and Councillor Rebick and I had the great pleasure of attending part of the summer holiday programme last year, and it was hugely impressive, I think we both say, and has actually, as you said, it's led to the administration investing money to make sure that Lethem and other communities can benefit from it. Really was an outstanding piece of work, and pleased to see members of school staff there supporting it. And I think, although we were disappointed, obviously, in the elements of the report, I think that underlying, you know, commitment of the staff, and I know that has carried on through the post-inspection in order to address the issues that have been highlighted, and that's really encouraging. And the other, Councillor Rebick and I, were also on the appointment for the new headteacher, and the enthusiasm from the parents and their absolute determination to get the right person in post in order to move things forward was again equally encouraging. So a really good foundation to build on. The fact that the council, the folk from Education and Children's Service, were aware of the issues also before the inspection, so that work had begun, again gives us encouragement that this is a journey that will have a very positive outcome for the young learners at Lethem. So move on to any questions from elected members, or we'll just do questions and comments at the same time if yeah. Councillor Rebick.
Thank you, convener. I would just like to add really to what you've said and highlight the strengths of the school on page 17, actually, around the commitment of the head teacher, in this case the acting head teacher, and the deputy and all the staff, and indeed the QIO. Having been reasonably close to the school and very close to the community, I can absolutely say that that's 100% correct, as is the highly effective partnership working. And indeed, the children are polite and friendly, and they're absolutely a credit to their community. So I would just like to underline that is absolutely true. I think the fourth thing that's not stated in that report, but which Joe touched upon, is there is also a very supportive parent body, not just in the parent council, actually, but beyond that as well. And I think although there were challenges in the report, and indeed there's challenges, societal challenges, actually, which go beyond the school also, I think that these strengths are a really great place to start from in terms of moving forward. It would be really remiss, speaking about Lethem Primary, not to mention the Holiday Hunger Club, and it was superb. And I know that the convener and I have already had discussions, and I'm away to pester Sharon very shortly about making sure that we have the resource in place to make that sustainable this year and for many years going forward. I think that's really important. But it would also be remiss not to mention the great work that the school's done around adverse childhood experience as well, which I think is really important, because I think all these things are connected to education, and early intervention and stuff like that is really crucial. And I'd also welcome the new head teacher. The new head teacher is another step forward in going forward, but I absolutely know that he will have the support of the deputy head teacher and the staff going forward. And he, despite the challenges that have already been identified in the report and that we're already moving forward on, the new head teacher, I've no doubt, is coming in a very good school, and I look forward to the inspectors coming back at the end of the year when they will tell a completely different story to the one that's told in this report. Thank you.
Councillor McDade.
Thank you. I think it's good to hear that significant progress against the Rebec has already been made. I just wanted to probe a little bit further into a couple of areas, looking at the sort of the background survey information of the report around both children and staff identified children, the pupils' behaviour as a significant issue. And I'm just wondering if you can tell us a bit more about what's been done specifically to address that, because obviously that has a knock-on effect on everything else.
Okay, so in terms of the background information which you're referring to, some children did identify through the pupil questionnaires a feeling of or a lack of feeling safe in school, which is obviously a concern for us. We want our children to come to feel to school to feel safe and secure and happy. So since the inspection, we've done a lot of work in terms of making sure that that's the case. So we have completely reviewed our anti-bullying strategy, and that's been well shared with parents. Pupils have been fully involved in that. We have reviewed restorative approaches, and we're currently in the process of reviewing our previously known positive behaviour management policy, but which will now be known as positive relationships policy, because that's actually what underpins it all. And children, staff, parents and partners have been fully involved in terms of that. So as I say, work has been done, it continues to be done. It's a big focus for us. I lead weekly assemblies, and the focus is always around the scenario indicators, safety being one of the main ones. All the children are encouraged to have five to feel safe, where they have identified five adults or five different people within the school who they can go to if they have an issue. And that's working really well as well to ensure that children have somebody to speak to if there is a problem.
Follow up if I can. Yeah. No, thank you. I think that's really positive, and I'm pleased to hear about you talking a lot about involving parents, pupils, staff in that, because that was obviously one of the other things that was identified, was people weren't feeling involved. And my final sort of point was to pick up on 25% of staff disagreed with the fact that they got the opportunity to learn and share practice with other colleagues. So I'm just wanting to probe a wee bit further into what's been done around that.
So as I'd kind of mentioned, we now have planned time built into our collegiate calendar. So termly, where staff are encouraged to, well, and supported to work together to plan learning and teaching. So they have allocated time now to do that. We, as a management team, are supporting them with facilitating questions, but actually it's very much kind of led by the staff team, so they're fully involved in terms of that. So that's been a new development, which is working well so far.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask about the self-evaluation process that was referenced prior to the inspection? And obviously there was an ongoing an action plan even before you had the inspection. I think my opinion would be that an inspection really shouldn't tell you anything that you don't already know if your self-evaluation process is working possibly. So my question is, was there anything in the inspection that hadn't been identified previously and hadn't already been included in the action plan? And if so, was there any reason that was thought of as why that might have happened, if it did?
I think we, as a whole team, were not surprised. We agreed with the contents of the report, as we'd said. We had an ELA visit from the authority, which identified exactly the same priorities for improvement. And it's really just a process of time to ensure that improvement can be embedded. So the HMI inspection identified those same priorities, but also identified the same strengths. So that's kind of where we had felt that we were.
Sorry. No, it's fine if you want to come back to me. I just wanted to ask about timescales for some of the actions that you've identified. Obviously, you'll have a follow-up at some point, but even before then, are there some key milestones that you've got for the various actions that you've identified?
Um,
Yeah, so the school are have an action plan, as you say, which has timescales, so they have regular meetings with myself and with other colleagues who are supporting them, just to catch up and to check up on progress as well. So I'm in the school quite a lot and meet with the senior management team and review progress regularly, so that we can check that we're meeting those actions. Okay.
Councillor Wilson.
Thank you. Thanks for the presentation. That's quite an agenda, I think, is my initial comment. Along with Councillor Rebick and others, I attended the meeting at the public meeting at Lytham, and I think I took out of that a positivity. Was the one word I would use to describe it. Coming from that positive support from the staff who were there in reasonable numbers and the parents who were there in reasonable numbers, four points. And this was raised during the meeting a wee bit, is how to keep the momentum going. You know, it's fine to, there's the initial push for a number of weeks and a number of months, and as was raised by some of the parents, how will we know that there's a sufficient support given to the ongoing process? So would you like to give us some thoughts on that one first, please?
Yeah, thank you, Councillor Wilson. I suppose there's been a fair bit of momentum in terms of our work with Lethem since September 2016. When we first went in to review aspects of the practice within the school. I think it would be fair to say that Kim Ramsey, as Quality Improvement Officer, knows the school extremely well. In terms of the question about timescales and regular reviews of progress, it would be fair to say that over a period of the last 2 years, Kim has actually been in the school at least on a weekly basis. We do have what we term informally as a team around the school to support Lethem Primary, because it is a very big agenda. But what we don't want to do as a quality improvement team is to go in and impose our views of what the school should be doing. So therefore, we're absolutely behind the empowerment agenda of practitioners and the school community. So we are working with the school community to get that shared expectation of what is excellent relationships, excellent learning and teaching in Lethem Primary School. That takes more time than if you hand something over and tell people to get it done, but we feel it's valuable time worth doing, and we expect and hope, and there's good evidence to show that the positivity that you saw at the public meeting is as a result of that engagement, that ongoing engagement with parents and with partners. So in terms of how to keep that momentum going, provided that the school community are engaged and enthusiastic about what's going on within the school, we expect that momentum will continue. And we don't expect that it will stop just at the point where inspectors come back and tell us that we've made progress, because the work that will be required to ensure that Lethem is an excellent school will take, you know, time, and it's like painting the fourth road bridge, it never stops really.
Thanks for that. And just to follow on then, in relation to, and I use the old fashioned phrase staff morale, I guess there were disappointments amongst the staff about some of the results of the inspectorate, and I think we've handled that well from what I can initially see. But again, my question, how do we go the extra mile to just keep everybody focused on the improvement agenda? How we keep the spirits up, I suppose, is another thing, because it's not always a quick burn to make the improvements that you want to do. I think you were referring to that earlier on, Sharon, that some of these things are not immediate. You don't go into the room and turn on the light. So what are there any particular things that are happening just to make sure that the staff receive the support and vigour and enthusiasm, I suppose? Your presentation indicated that for a start, so that's good. But what else are we doing to help sustain the staff on what is quite a lengthy journey?
So absolutely, it's been really vital for me to kind of recognise staff morale as being something which we need to be considering at all times. Staff have had an awful lot of ownership in terms of the improvement agenda and to lead on aspects of that, which has ensured that they have kind of felt part of the journey, that they can see kind of the steps that we're taking and see the improvements that we are making on an ongoing basis. The pace has been significant, but it's also about us as a management team kind of within the school, but also with me liaising with Kim and with Sharon, as to kind of taking a step back at times to kind of take stock of what we've achieved and allowing staff that time to kind of reflect and embed on what we have done. There's absolutely no point, as Sharon had said, on kind of ploughing on with things for the sake of it when we actually need to ensure that our staff, we're taking them with us at all times. And I think we've managed to get that absolutely right so far. And with the new head teacher starting, I'm confident that that will continue. So bringing in some new enthusiasm, some new energy to the team, new expertise as well will be of real benefit.
I'm going to now ask a wee bit about the parental body, because they're a crucial partner in the process. And in a kind of a way, a report like this helps emphasise maybe the need for parents to come on board. If everything jogs along fine, in many schools, the parents just are happy and their engagement maybe isn't high. Has the from the meeting that John and I were at, there was obviously a lot of parental interest and support. Again, how do we maintain and sustain that over a period of time? Because the same questions I made in relation to the staff and generally apply to this. And how, maybe in a year's time, are we looking towards refreshing that? Because that will be a challenge at the time. Well, we've done all of these things. I know that the holiday meals, I've got to stop calling it holiday hunger, so I'm not quite sure what the replacement suggestion is in that. But and that will have an effect as well, I think. So how have we any medium term plan for the parental interest factor? That's a difficult question, I acknowledge.
So we continue to strive to engage parents in the best way that we can. As I touched upon, we have a really supportive parent council at the moment, and a number of different parents have recently joined the parent council as well. So we've kind of got a much wider spread of, I suppose, parents across the school. So we're hearing kind of different voices, which is a kind of the first positive step, I would say. As a staff team working alongside the parent council and parent body, we communicate regularly to find out the best ways of engaging parents. So as I touched upon, our stay and learn sessions are always really well attended. Parent contact is very well attended, so that's our opportunity to really seek the views of parents. So knowing our parent body and utilising the opportunities that we have to work with them. As you say, in terms of going forward, it's just about constant self-evaluation, reflection, but relationships are absolutely at the heart of that, and making sure we've got really strong relationships with our parents, which we're proud that we do, is going to continue to support in terms of engaging them in the longer term.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Wilson. Joe, can I ask about, you talked about the use of Seesaw, and you talked about pupils and how they would know that they've been successful. And obviously our aspiration for them is that they all attain, you know, as well as they possibly can, and that we're ambitious for their futures. And how's that been received, and has there been any noticeable improvement in the children's, you know, aspirations in terms of their sort of knuckling down and you know, pushing themselves on to achieve more? Are you able to tell us more about that?
Absolutely. So as I touched upon already, we're seeing through pupil learner conversations and classroom observations that children are absolutely much more able to reflect and articulate on what they're learning, why they're learning it, the steps they need to take to be successful, and their next steps. When we have been in classes through kind of learning walks and more formal observations, we're seeing children who are much more engaged with their learning, who are able to engage with their learning for longer periods of time, and who have become or are becoming much more confident learners, which, as you said, that's kind of what we aspire for them to be. Towards the end of last session, we did a huge focus on a careers fair,
which was very well received by the children. All the children kind of identified different jobs that they wanted to do when they were older, and every child had somebody visit the school who was part of that job, which included having llamas in the playground and things like that. So that was a really exciting day. But as I said, in terms of building on that, we absolutely recognise that our focus is the kind of skills for life learning and work agenda, pupil leadership, committees, pupils having ownership within the school, and we expect that will also support children to have high aspirations and expectations for themselves and what they can achieve.
Can only be a good day when you've got a llama in the playground, I'm sure. Any further questions or comments, Councillor Wilson?
Just one briefly, when I'm not sure if there's much call for llama keepers in Letham, but I defer to Councillor Revick's knowledge of the area, which is greater than mine. But that's interesting. On the recommendation that was given, and if you covered this in your address, I'm sorry, has that, where are we implementing the recommendation for the, this was for the nursery class? This was the issue about, I think, getting to the visiting the loo. Has that been resolved?
Yeah. So at the moment, as you may or may not be aware, we're having significant works undertaken across the school in relation to our nursery expansion in preparation for the 1140 hours. So the recommendation has been addressed already through that with safety locks kind of popped on doors and things like that, and adults supporting children when needed to access the toilet. So that's been addressed and will continue to with the improving property works.
Thank you.
Any further comments or questions? No. Joe, thank you very much for all you've done, because we know that you've shown huge personal commitment to working with the staff team to take this forward, and we look forward to the next chapter when the new head teacher comes in. But please take back our thanks to the staff, the pupils and the parents, and I'm sure we'll all look forward to a visit up to Letham in the near future. But just please take our personal thanks to yourself and your team. Thank you. And that takes us on to Roger and Perth High School.
Thank you, Convener. I would like to introduce the paper or the feedback following the Perth High School inspection, which took place between the 5th of to the 9th of November 2018. Prior to this, Perth High School was last inspected in 2007. And between those times, we've supported the school through a range of extended learning and achievement visits, which have brought forward various improvements for the school to take on. The evaluations for Perth High School are found on page 22 of the report, and we note that the Perth and Kinross expectations are a good or better, and these evaluations are slightly below that, which is disappointing, but to a degree came out of similar evidence that we had gathered through our extended learning achievement visits. However, based on the areas of improvement and the positive actions the school is taking, we're confident that the school will overtake the PKC expectations. I'm going to pass over to my colleague, Donald McLeod, Quality Improvement Officer, who will take us through some of the areas of recommendations.
Thank you, Roger, and good morning. I'd like to give you some context, some detail around the context of the school and the inspection also, and then describe the strengths of the school that were highlighted through the inspection process. Perth High School is a six-year non-denominational comprehensive secondary school which serves the southern and eastern parts of the city of Perth, as well as the villages and rural areas to the south and east of Perth. Most pupils transfer to Perth High School from the partner primary schools of Abernethy, Abernight, Craigie, Dunbarney, Errol, Forgandenny, Inchstuart, Inchhew, Invergowrie, Canoole, Longforgan, Moncrief, Oakbank and St Meadows. The profile of Perth High School will change slightly in the next academic year, with young people from Dunbarney and Forgandenny transitioning to Bertha Park High School. Mrs. Thurza Pupillo became head teacher of Perth High School in August 2016. Mrs. Pupillo was supported in her senior leadership team by four deputy head teachers who each have whole school strategic responsibilities delegated to them. There's also a business manager who ensures the business continuity of the school. In recent years, and as highlighted by the inspection team, the school has experienced considerable staffing changes. Perth High School, as Roger said, was inspected from Monday the 5th to Friday the 9th of November 2018. At the time of the inspection, the school roll was 1,424 pupils, with 107 full-time equivalent teaching staff across 16 teaching departments, each of which has a principal teacher, and also five principal teachers at guidance and pupil support teachers. The inspection team itself consisted of 14 inspectors, including associate assessors who are secondary school head teachers, inspectors with particular expertise in curricular areas of pupil support and inclusion, for example. There were inspectors who focused on nutrition, health and well-being, and also those who were shadowing more experienced inspectors. During the week, there were over 80 classroom observations. There were five focus groups of young people, two focus groups of parents, a range of meetings with strategic leaders, close scrutiny of documentation, staff meetings, meeting with parents, literacy and numeracy and health and well-being meetings, daily meetings with the head teacher, and also parental and pupil surveys. And we're delighted that 1,000 of the 1,400 young people responded to the surveys. There was about 100 parents of the school community who responded to those surveys. This was, as Roger said, a full inspection model that made evaluations of the quality indicators of leadership of change, learning, teaching and assessment, raising attainment and achievement, and ensuring well-being, equality and inclusion. The inspection also considered the school's own choice quality indicator of partnerships. This, however, is not a graded evaluation. Each of the quality indicators were evaluated as being satisfactory, as Roger said, and satisfactory on the Higgius, how good is our school, for a 6-point scale indicates that strength outweigh areas for improvement, but also indicates that there are areas of improvement activity that are required to be undertaken. The 6-point scale, when it is applied for the whole of a quality indicator and not individual themes within it. And also that consistency across a school system is a major influencing factor in the decision-making process when awarding a grading to a quality indicator. Perth High School was last inspected in 2007, and the most recent inspection in Perth and Kinross, in a secondary school in Perth and Kinross, was Creef High School in March 2014. The Higgius 4 framework of evaluation that is considered to be an enhanced expectation was introduced in 2015, and therefore no secondary school in Perth and Kinross has been inspected under this framework. And the strengths that the Education Scotland team found in the school were that the better relationships policy, which is beginning to improve clarity, communication and consistency, and how positive relationships are developed across the school. It is helping teachers across all classrooms to establish a more positive climate for learning. The report also highlighted that the recently implemented better relationships policy, alongside the behaviour blueprint, are highlighted as having a positive impact upon the quality indicators of learning, teaching and assessment, and ensuring well-being and quality and inclusion. And this will enable the school to move these quality indicators into the good, at least, evaluation category over time. It was also highlighted that the range of opportunities which young people have to achieve and develop their skills as a strength. These include after-school and lunchtime clubs in music and sports, and a very proactive and successful chaplaincy group. The report also indicates that this is having a positive impact on the overall quality of learners' achievements that are celebrated and recognised regularly. This helps young people to feel valued and is developing the skills of better communication, leadership, collaboration, confidence and team building. A further strength that was highlighted was the increasing and successful nature of the school's work with local, national and international partners. And that, as I said, was the school's own choice quality indicator of partnerships. So this is providing young people with new and interesting experiences to enhance their learning. The report describes that there are a growing number of partnerships with local, national and international organisations, and as well as businesses, and this has increased the range of learning experiences from which young people can benefit. Community links are becoming recognised as an aspect of the life and work of school, and the school's positive profile within the business and third sectors continues to grow. Young people's understanding about the world of work is developing through a range of activities, including mentoring and business links. These learning experiences, as highlighted in the report, demonstrate senior leaders' understanding of the importance of using partners in curriculum delivery to enhance young people's experiences. The school is also working effectively to involve parents as key stakeholders in its processes for planning for improvement. In response to parental feedback from consultation, a number of changes have been introduced, including the format and content of parents' evenings. Senior leaders are keen to support greater parental engagement. The report also highlighted that the head teacher and the deputy head teachers provide supportive and consultative leadership, and that the recently developed values with stakeholders from the school community of ambition, respect, and equity are having a positive impact. Under the banner of curriculum, it is highlighted that from S4 to S6, the school with partners provides a commendable variety of learning pathways for young people. I wanted to highlight also that a meeting was held on the 11th of March to provide members of the school community with more detail about the inspection and to provide an update on the improvement activity that the school has been undertaking. Mrs. Pupillo and her senior leadership team presented high-level messages on their areas of strategic responsibility. This was very well attended, with around 80 parents and also elected members. And Mrs. Pupillo and Education and Children's Services greatly appreciate the support of elected members through these processes. This also provided an opportunity for parents to ask some questions on the areas for improvement. The meeting was well received, with useful feedback for the school and Education and Children's Services. Before Mrs. Pupillo takes you through the areas of improvement that were highlighted, Education Scotland have said that they will request a progress report from Perth and Kinross Council on the areas for improvement 1 year from the publication of the inspection report, and will then decide if further engagement with the school is required. I'm going to pass on to Mrs. Pupillo.
Okay, good morning, everybody. We're pleased that our areas of strength were recognised and our identified areas for improvement were confirmed by Education Scotland. I would like to highlight that Education Scotland recognised that our staff are committed to implementing change. It was recognised that our tagline, "We are Perth High School," which encompasses our values of ambition, respect and equity, is raising the profile of our vision and values. It was clear that we should continue to promote these consistently in everything we do and throughout our plans for the future. In November, we drew up a four-month plan based on the verbal feedback that we had been given by Education Scotland. This encompassed our current improvement plan. This included our plans for the two in-service days in November and February and our immediate actions. There were four identified areas of development outlined by Education Scotland. Our first area of development is to develop a clearer, unified sense of direction and purpose in taking forward key aspects of school improvement. This should be informed carefully by information which the school has gathered on its own strengths and weaknesses, and take account of the views of staff, young people, parents and partners. Over the past 4 months, we have created a 2020 vision, a vision that has clarity and a sense of direction with clear timescales. It is a vision that is underpinned by our values and sets out our expectations for better relationships and better learning. It encompasses the learning experience, our whole school ethos, and meeting the needs of our young people. In taking this forward, each department has created a 12-step plan to ensure that the vision is implemented in a consistent way across the school. The vision has a clear deadline of February 2020. Throughout the year, there will be opportunities for us to seek views from all of our stakeholders about the progress within this process. I am confident that we have made progress in addressing the first area of development and addressing other areas that were given to us verbally and are mentioned within the report. These include our actions to ensure that young people feel safe, happy and achieving in school. The better relationship policy, which was mentioned in the report, ensure that all staff were clear about our approaches to enhancing the ethos and culture within Perth High School. In December, we held an anti-bullying summit with pupils, and a draft policy has been written. It has been issued to all stakeholders for feedback, and it will be launched with all staff during our April in-service day. The pupils were clear that they wanted a speak-up culture, one that does not tolerate any form of bullying. We have also looked at improving attendance, reviewing our systems to increase rigour in tracking attendance, which will enable earlier interventions and therefore better learning. Development area two was to review the curriculum so that all young people receive their entitlement to broad general education. Departments have reviewed their broad general education courses against national experiences outcomes and national benchmarks to ensure that we have the right pathways to enable the highest number of young people to achieve fourth level by the end of S3. We have also modified our curricular structure within S3 to allow for improved personalisation and choice. Development area three was to ensure that all young people can engage consistently in challenging, motivating, well-paced learning experience which meets their needs. Learning and teaching is our core business, and the actions that we have taken have enabled staff to focus on the purpose of lessons as well as the expectations within each lesson. Our learning and teach working group, which was already established, has designed a new learning and teaching blueprint, which was introduced during the February inset day. This is aimed at increasing pace and challenge across the school. Strategies have been devised to ensure that high quality teaching leads to high quality learning. This includes increased rigour in our quality assurance of the learner's experience, which include lesson observations, pupil voice and feedback, and regular meetings with principal teachers and the senior leadership team. Development area four was to provide staff with planned opportunities to engage together in professional learning. These should be linked to helping them develop their skills and confidence in assessing, tracking, and monitoring young people's progress effectively. They should also be linked to developing their understanding of how to support the needs of all young people consistently. We have a working group that are currently considering the way in which we track the progress of our young people in S1 to S3 and the use of data that we have available to us. Departments have and will continue to engage in moderation not only of outcomes but also of planning. This has led to a shared understanding of the standards. Staff understanding of how to support the needs of all young people ensures that young people are supported consistently. Since the report was issued towards the end of January, I've met with a variety of staff, all principal teachers, teaching and support staff, as well as pupil focus groups, to listen to their thoughts on the report and our plans for the future. The public meeting was held on the 11th of March, where parents took the opportunity to clarify some of the plans further, and it was clear that parents would like regular updates on our progress. I am confident that our planned approaches over the next 12 months will allow us to implement the 2020 vision and each of the areas for improvement. Each of these are being strategically led by the senior leadership team working across and alongside principal teachers and their teams. Our collegiate approach to improvements will enhance the experience and outcomes for all young people at Perth High School.
Thank you very much, Donald and Thursday. Councillor Wilson, Councillor Rebick and I were all at the public meeting, as you said, and it really was a very positive and productive meeting. What Councillor Wilson and I discussed afterwards, and I haven't had the opportunity to discuss it with Councillor Rebick, but the presentation style on the evening I thought was really, really good. I really thought that each of the deputy heads in particular had really grasped onto their specific area of responsibility and very clearly articulated how they were going to take things forward. So that if you could perhaps feed that back to them, it really was a very I wasn't quite sure how the evening was going to pan out, but I think the fact that each of them stood up and articulated so well the next steps was really productive. If I could just indulge the committee and go through my questions first, that would be good. Some of the points that I took back from the public meeting that parents had asked, which I thought might be quite helpful just for those who weren't there to hear, it was about quality assurance process, consistency of teaching across the school, and what parents could expect to see in relation to that, and the improvements and that process of regular updates to parents was something that there was definitely a real appetite for. They also talked a lot about the changes that there had been in staffing, and I know that that's a national issue and perhaps a little bit affected by that, but obviously there was a real concern there about, and you did articulate back to the link into the consistency and the quality assurance and actually how that would mitigate against the impact of this changing staffing, and how parents in particular would know that things had got better on a and how quickly that would happen. So those were the kind of areas that I would like if we could delve into a wee bit more, and then we'll come to the rest of the committee. Thanks.
Okay, if I start off then with the processes for quality assurance, obviously an increased rigour is what's required through our process. We do have a departmental review process which the senior leadership team visit departments on a regular basis, carry out observations, speak with pupils and gather data around what the pupil experience is within the departments. That process needs to be increased, and the frequency of that process needs to be increased to ensure that we're visiting all departments through every year that we have within the school. We also think that the process with teachers observing each other, so that there's peer observation and there's that feeling of empowerment within the staff themselves, that they're encouraging each other and looking at the basic learning and teaching blueprint that we've created as a basis for that, is the process that we will use to increase the sharing of good practice across the school as well. So the process that will be fed back to parents would be communications around the visits that have taken place and the quality of the learning and teaching that we've seen within those departments. You touched on also staffing and the range or the changes in staffing that we've had. When the inspectors visited in November, we had 107 members of the teaching staff. Approximately 12 of those were new to our school in August 2018. So there was a large changeover in the number of staff that were with us sort of 10 weeks into the term when the inspectors visited us. So understandably, when it's a new team like that, the consistency is key. And that's something that we've taken on board and thinking of when every new member of staff comes to join us, about being clear about what our expectations are towards within the classroom, around the school, in terms of behaviour relationships, particularly positive relationships, and also the expectations for learning and teaching within the classroom. So that's something that we've learned for new members of staff coming to join us as part of our staffing changes.
And can I just ask about the updates to parents? What form will they?
Yeah, the updates to parents, what we've done since the inspection and since the beginning of the year is created a monthly newsletter. So I envisage that will be part of the process, but also regular updates through the parent council. We have regular meetings with our parent council, and I see that's an opportunity to share maybe some more of the detail about what we're doing throughout all the different development areas that we have.
And my final one, then I will let the committee come in. The survey that the inspectors, that was sent out to parents during the inspection, you said that 100 parents replied. Is that kind of about the level we'd expect, or would we have been expecting more than that?
It's always difficult to judge just how many parents will engage with a process. I think very much it depends on the discussion topic that's been sent out as communication. One of the things that I'm going to put out with my March newsletter this year is just that very fact, a questionnaire about how is best to communicate and what is best way to get parental engagement with our school. We've had quite a lot of feedback with our anti-bullying policy, and members of the parent body have actually come in to meet with Mr. Cunningham, our deputy support, who has been leading on that. So that's slightly less than a 10% level of engagement. So, we would hope that we can increase the number of parental responses in any survey that we do.
And you talked about pupil voice, and you said that you'd introduce a "you said we did" type
That's right.
approach. And is that being well received?
That's one of the mechanisms whereby we want pupils to be able to see what's been said and what actions have been taken. So it's at early days yet. We're hoping that every department will have that by the next in-service day, which is in April. So it's early stages, but that should have an impact on the feeling that what is being said is then being implemented.
Thank you. Councillor Wilson and Councillor McDade.
Thanks, Camilla. Thanks for the presentation. I have quite a few questions. I'm not uncritical of HMI reports, as some folk in this room will be aware. Were you disappointed by the report?
I wasn't disappointed by the report itself. I suppose there were elements within there that we hope may be recognised as areas of strength, but I felt that the process was a very fair process, and I felt that the inspection itself was a positive experience. We had a very good dialogue throughout the week that the inspectors were in with us. We talked about the practice that we had and the practice that we needed to look beyond our own school, our own authority, and where we could maybe seek examples of practice that might influence a setting that was similar to ourselves, like other schools across Scotland.
Thank you for that. I mean, it's interesting, and speaking to some of the senior pupils, their comment to me was they were everywhere. It's almost like and even asking questions in the corridors was what they said, so they were certainly thorough. Just building on the point of expectation, do you think the inspectors missed any bit of the good work of Perth High School? I suppose that's, did you get a fair kick at the ball in terms of their reflection of all the good things that happened at the school? Do you feel there was anything? And that might just be an emphasis or a view on what happened. Do you think there was anything they missed, because it's not a perfect process?
No, I think they recognise the strengths that we have at Perth High School, and they certainly, as you say, talked with a lot of our young people who shared their experiences, particularly around the wider opportunities that are available to the young people at Perth High School, and also particularly our partnership working, which was recognised in our strengths. I would say that we had a fair visit in recognising our strengths as well.
You mentioned the newsletter, correctly so, and thank you for the copies that you're sending to, I think, elected members as well. I've certainly had one. I don't know if that's the elected members in Perth South or the, no, if the convener's not had one. I'll show you mine.
Take any offence.
It's the ward.
The elected members in Perth South are more than happy to receive them. There's a lot of good news in that. What are your plans to do a bit more of that, just trying to get more positivity in the press? It's very easy to get a headline in the Courier that the fire alarm's been set off, and but it's harder to say that XYZ group of pupils or A pupils excelled in some particular thing, whether it's art, social activities, whether it's sport, etc. Have you a plan for doing that? Because this is the hearts and minds stuff that we've got to concentrate on. So what are your thoughts about that?
We actually work very closely with one of our technicians, sends every good news story that we have to our local papers with photographs, or they're invited in to report on and take photographs of the good news stories that we have. So that's an ongoing process. Obviously, we have several Twitter pages as well, the overall Perth High Twitter page, and also lots of departmental ones. So I think it's continuing to you know, use all the good news that happens and making sure that that is being promoted throughout our local community. And obviously the community of Perth High School is one that stretches right down to Dundee, and that's making sure that we encompass being the heart of the community and the catchment area of Perth High School. And that probably is quite a tricky one, because the school doesn't sit maybe just quite in the heart of the community that it serves. So we need to make sure that we are reaching everybody.
Okay, that leads me very much into my next topic, which is community engagement, because I'm part of the community that you're there. And Donald spoke about looking at new opportunities for further engagement with community, and I know that you've taken on extra staff in terms of welfare team, and that involves just making sure the talented young people are actually in the school and studying, rather than having a wee visit to the local shop or whatever. How is that going to be strengthened in terms of supporting pupils and so on? Because there have been issues in the past, and if these continue, then I think that's something you would want to, I know you're addressing. So do you want to say something about that?
Obviously, it's working very closely with the partners that we have in the very near vicinity of the school. And I know that we work closely with yourself, Councillor Wilson, with the local businesses that our young people frequent at lunchtimes and maybe after school as well. And again, it's about creating the positive relationships between the local businesses and local neighbourhood. We as part of our business partnerships, are looking to create opportunities for our young people to demonstrate the skills that they have in being responsible citizens and being positive role models for the younger pupils. And I think when we do have events that are happening at the school, inviting some of our local neighbours in, working closely with them, like the Viewland Ventures, where they're actually working collectively on a piece of project work, is obviously positive. Like our Trishaw, where they're involving local community and intergenerational work, where there's projects that reach out across the city of Perth and not just the local neighbourhood itself. So it's about, as you rightly went back to, about the positive relationships and partnerships that can be made across the community have a positive impact on the local community.
Convener, just one more point, and it's a dual question really. At the meeting we were at, there was obviously a lot of parental support there. There was positivity about it as well, although there were very good questions. And staff morale, just kind of the same question asked of Letham. How do you sustain that over what is quite a lengthy period? Because it's fine for the first rush of that, but how do you keep that momentum going? I know you've got another in-service day in April. So what's your plans for keeping the parental involvement going, as well as the newsletter, obviously, I'm presumably working through the parent council, but also making sure the staff are kept appraised of things, but also that they're supported?
I think the main thing for staff is that feeling of empowerment, that you're involved in a process of progress. And there's very much been and recognised by Education Scotland that our staff are really willing to implement change. We are working together to plan what the what changes need to be made and have been, not just for the past 4 months, but over a longer period of time. Our better relationship policy was something that was developed very closely with all our stakeholders, and that's not just something that's happened overnight. It was a long process in gathering the views of exactly what should be the right thing for our context at Perth High School, and it very much was about promoting positive relationships that all stakeholders would buy into. And staff have felt very much involved in that process. And I think the morale of staff has been that, well, we are determined to make sure that the positive changes take place for the benefit of all the young people at Perth High School. And we want it to be recognised that we're doing that together. It's not something that one person can do, it's not something that two people can do, it's something that a whole team has to do in departments and across the school. And when you're talking about a very large body of people, you know, over 100 staff, over 100 teaching staff, support staff, you know, facilities manager staff, dining staff, it's a very large organisation. And that buy-in from the staff and buy-in to the vision that we have is extremely important in making sure that we all feel involved in taking things forward in the right direction for the benefit of our young people.
Thank you.
Councillor McDade.
Thank you. Obviously it's disappointing for everyone that it was rated satisfactory, and I'm sure you yourself are more disappointed than anyone else. But as you say, there's lots of positive things that were also in the report, and that's very positive for the staff as well. And my point is around really what I think is a cross-cutting theme, having looked at the sort of the background feedback, which is around communication. I'm going to break it down to staff and pupils, if that's okay with you. So obviously there was some quite strong feedback in there about communication. 66% of teaching staff felt that there wasn't adequate communication at all levels, and 42% felt that when they reported an incident, there wasn't feedback from that incident. And also the 63% of support staff who felt they didn't feel like a valued member of the school community. So I think, you know, there was quite strong feedback around communications in there, and I think that, if in my view, affects a lot of the other issues that will be a cross-cutting theme, as it were. So I'm just sort of wanting to probe a bit more about how that is being addressed, because it is such a big issue, clearly, that it really requires a bit of a step change.
I think the communication, obviously there was the different layers as you talked about. First of all, there was a staff level of communication, and we've gone back and unpicked that a bit, if you like, to find out, well, what does that actually mean, and what do you mean by the communication within the staff body? And part of our more structured approach to meetings with principal teachers and structures for meetings with teams has been implemented since the survey results have taken place. So, for example, the deputies are meeting with their principal teachers regularly as a one-to-one, and the structure of the departmental meetings is obviously there on the school calendar for that improved communication to be followed through. So the groups that I have met with since the publishing of the report have been principal teachers, teachers, support staff. And the support staff, the feeling that you said about feeling valued, that can come down to, when we teased it out, it comes down to very much about the personal touch and about recognition of the role that everybody carries out within a school. And we're looking at ways that we can adjust what we do in our everyday life, and that part of that is possibly just being more visible in and around the school. For example, myself, it's a big organisation, sometimes you get entrenched in paperwork or emails, so it's about rethinking about what you do on a day-to-day basis and making sure that you're appreciating everybody that's within the roles that they have within the school body, and every day ensuring that the processes that are in place are supporting the people that are doing the jobs that need to be done around the school environment. The other part I think you mentioned was about pupils and the importance of pupil voice, and certainly in the better behaviour, better relationships policy that we've adapted, and also the anti-bullying policy that we've recently had, that was very much based on the voice from the pupils during the anti-bullying summit, gathering their views and also the feedback that they've given us about the policy so far and what they feel about what they've been doing. So obviously it's a greater relationship about being heard about what the views are, but also, as we talked about, the you said we did, it's about following up with what have the actions been since we've collected your views, what have you done with them, and what are the obvious changes that have been made because of the views that have been expressed, and demonstrating those in a very visible way, in quite a simple way, but a very visible way, is the you said we did version.
Yeah, no, I think that's very positive around the pupil voice in particular, because obviously, and I'm pleased to hear about the bullying review of the strategy review there, because obviously that was another key area of concern that was expressed by the pupils. I think the biggest area of concern from my point of view that was expressed by the pupils was that only 16% felt comfortable approaching staff with questions all of the time, and that's quite a big deal from my point of view. If you're a pupil in a classroom and only about 16% of the time you're feeling comfortable asking questions all of the time, that's pretty concerning, because that's a key component of learning, obviously. So, obviously there is the staff communication, but also there is that classroom level communication. So I'm just wondering what's been done to essentially break down that barriers between, and that's quite a significant barrier, because that doesn't change overnight if pupils don't feel comfortable asking teacher who has perhaps been a teacher for several years, questions. I think that maybe feeds into, how hard people are potentially finding their work. I think it was about 33% said that they found the work hard all the time. Perhaps that is because they're not feeling comfortable asking questions. So, what is being done essentially to break those barriers down around communication within the classroom as well?
I think our learning teacher blueprint that we've developed since has encompassed opportunities for that to happen. Obviously, the personal learning planning process is part of that, whereby there's regular one-to-one discussions with pupils, and where somebody might not feel confident to speak with or ask a question in front of a whole class, the regular one-to-one opportunities should lead to that feeling of more comfortable discussion. Maybe not in front of the whole class, but on a regular basis that way. So it's part of a process that we're looking at individual target setting and individual discussions about each person's learning. So I see that as part of the increased focus and rigour around learning and teaching within the classroom.
So that's very positive, and I think, Convener, you approached it on it earlier about the sort of learning teaching strategy and the review of that. I think part of obviously the idea of curriculum for excellence was breaking it down in terms of the different modes of study, and you know, if it's not all essentially whiteboard teaching or whatever, that allows pupils perhaps the opportunity to ask those questions more. So I think that is a very positive step, and you know, look forward to hearing more about how that has developed. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Rebick.
Thank you, Convener. I think it's a comment which maybe leads into a little bit of a question about challenge, both for the school and actually us as a local authority around staff levels, because any business or organisation with 107, I think it is, employees, is going to have a flow of staff, whether it's career advancement, ambition, sickness, maternity leave, dare I say it, stress, and a school's not going to be immune to that. I think, and I guess my open-ended question is, are we dealing with that as a school and also as an authority effectively enough? Because I think a lot of the lack of consistency, quite rightly, the good practice that is there needs to be administered more consistently, and maybe the staff turnover is a reason and not an excuse why that consistency is maybe not where it should be. So I think that's my question of challenges. Are we dealing with it effectively?
Councillor Rowett, I'll take that question. In terms of the staffing for the school, the staffing for Perth High School, like all other secondary schools within Perth and Ross, is based upon a staffing standard. The staffing standard is based upon numbers, it's essentially role numbers, and within various stages, an allocation of staffing to that. If we take Perth High School last year, and Thursday was talking about the 12 new members of staff that came on board, a large number of those were probationary teachers, which came in for 1 year. And Perth High School has traditionally taken a large number of probationary teachers. That number will reduce a bit this year for going forward, because the role for next year in terms of staff numbers will be 100, because we're seeing a slight change in the numbers due to the opening of Bertha Park. So we're looking for consistency across the piece. We value the role of probationers coming into our schools because they add an oomph, a different view. Bringing in new staff into the complement is always excellent. And a number of the probationers, I think, from Perth High School, we're looking to retain those probationers because of the excellent quality of those members of staff. So I think there is a challenge in terms of maintaining that consistency, but we do that in terms of an overview across the piece in terms of the total number of staff. We take Perth High School with 100 FTE across all of our schools, secondary schools, we're looking at an FTE of 593.
Can I come? Oh, sorry.
Donald was just going to come in.
If I can just explore a little bit further, but we're encouraging our schools to consider their curriculum, particularly in the broad general education, in relation to and response to things like staffing challenges. And we've seen that there have been adverts for recruitment that have been on a number of occasions, and they're not eliciting applicants, and therefore we have to consider the curriculum, particularly in the broad general education. The senior phase is more difficult in relation to the specialism that's required to deliver the curricular areas. But what we're doing is we're encouraging that you consider the curriculum if vacancies cannot be filled, and therefore you maximise the capacity you have within the system to ensure that all the curricular areas are being addressed.
Thank you very much for both your answers. I stress at this point that I wasn't trying to be critical, just acknowledging the problems that any organisation with 107 staff are going to face with turnover and stuff like that. And if I can just add as well my thanks to Thursday, the head teacher, for her hospitality and my visit, and the openness that was shown. It was, and the positive message that we got from that was really good. I think the better relationships policy, because I get a right for calling it anti-bullying, is to be applauded, and I think that will make a difference. And as I say, I think the key to it strikes me is that the key is not reinventing the wheel, it's just to get the really good stuff that's already done at Perth High School applied more consistently. But thank you very much anyway.
Before I bring Councillor Purvis in, just a follow-on from that question, one of the points that was brought up at the public meeting by parents was about professional development opportunities for staff, and the this was a question that was obviously of interest to the parents, which I found interesting that parents were bringing that up. Could have been a teacher that's a parent as well, I suppose. And is that something that you're able to give us some more information on?
Professional development for staff obviously very much is on a individual basis as well as whole school. So in November we already had planned a whole day training around our better relationship policy. That was provided by an external provider that gave us an overview about managing positive relationships, recognising the positives, having a relentless routine, etc., etc. So that was a whole body of staff that took part in the same training. The individual professional development is very much based on their needs that come or arise throughout the year. Obviously, over the past 2 or 3 years, we've been very much looking at the changes in SQA and the difference in change requirements for the exams. So there's been a lot of professional development and understanding standards events that staff have attended to ensure that they understand the standards across for each of the subject areas. We also have curricular networks which departments from across Perth and Kinross work together on their subject specialisms. There's opportunities throughout the year, but particularly an in-service day in November is dedicated to the subject areas within the curricular network. We had already identified also that we would be spending our February in-service day with a focus on learning and teaching. Our working group had been established last August, and that was what we had decided would be the focus of that day. And it was very much around the learning and teaching blueprint and looking at pace and challenge within our lessons and the structures to support our young people in meeting their needs. So through the employee review development, obviously individual needs are identified, and anything that may be relevant to an individual is sought. And there's a system in place for supporting anybody or any individual that may need a specific professional learning opportunity, but also on a whole school level. And that's very much what the report talked about, having a shared understanding, particularly of moderation across the school. And that's what we've been focusing in on in the time that we have for in service.
Thank you. Councillor Purvis.
Thank you, convener. On a similar theme to my first question about Letham Primary School, about self-evaluation, Mr. Hill, you referenced that many of the points that were raised by the inspectors had been identified in advance. I think, however, I remember from a previous conversation that in terms of the assessment of the quality indicators, there was a discrepancy between when what the school had assessed and what we as an authority had assessed to be the outcome of those, and what the inspectors had come out with at the end of the inspection. I suppose my question is that a deficiency in the self-evaluation process in terms of actually what is happening in the school and what the processes are and the level at which we're performing, or is that, given that this is the first assessment inspection undertaken for a high school in Perth and Kinross for the new system, that we, although we know what's going on, didn't quite know exactly how that matches up to which level in terms of the 6-point scale, or a combination of both?
I think you're probably, Councillor Purvis, it's probably a combination of both. I'm going to ask my colleague Donald to come back in on the back of this. I think we'd carried out the self-evaluation with the school, had been taking place, and I think there was a slightly different emphasis in terms of the quality indicators across the piece of how the inspectors graded the quality indicators, with a slightly different emphasis. Some of the research work that had gone on before was looking at all the previous inspection reports that had taken place from last summer through to the inspection taking place in November, to look at how they were reporting, and within that we felt that we came up with the view of the school with the school was good across the board. But there was a slightly different emphasis. I think Don would maybe want to add in a wee bit to that.
Of course, thanks, Roger. As highlighted, we visited the school in June 2017, and many of the areas of improvement that were identified are similar to what the Education Scotland identified, and where the school is on the journey towards these improvement activities. And I think that we would indicate that there perhaps could have been increased pace of change in relation to these areas of improvement. You do highlight, Councillor Purvis, about the national benchmark in relation to how good is our school for, and that enhanced expectation that we weren't party to an inspection since the introduction of that, and there has been an incredible amount of change in Scottish education since the introduction of that framework, including the Scottish Attainment Challenge, developing the young workforce, continued revamp of the national qualifications. So there's a pace of change nationally that schools have had to deal with. But you're absolutely right, it's a combination of both the things you highlighted.
Councillor Wilson has a brief.
Just a follow up to that, I'm sorry I forgot this point earlier on. 2007 to 2018, I never thought I'd ask this question because I've always thought we're inspected to almost to the eyeballs, but that's a 10, 11 year gap, I think. Is that the right gap? And maybe Mr. Hill wants to answer that.
It's not, frankly, it's not the right gap. And we would expect any secondary school or any school to be inspected within a cycle of up to 7 years. And we haven't been. And that's up for Education Scotland to make the decision as to why we haven't been inspected up to that point with the secondary schools, because primary schools have continued during that time. And we would welcome inspections with our schools to have additional scrutiny.
If I may, I recently did an analysis of the inspections carried out in the last 18 months. There have only been 26 secondary school full inspections in the last 18 months in Scotland, and only four of those were schools which had a roll of above 1,200.
Any further comments or questions? No. Thank you very much, Mrs. Papillo, for your contribution this morning. I thought the public meeting was very much a kind of onwards and upwards tone. A lot of parents have been in touch with myself and I know Councillor Wilson and Councillor Rebick to say that they were very happy with the way that their child was progressing in the school, and that the inspection and the press that had gone around it did not necessarily reflect their personal experience of Perth High School. And I think we would want to do everything we can to support the school in building up that very public recognition of some of the really good work that I've seen myself on visits to the school is going on a week by week basis. I had the pleasure of spending last Thursday morning with some Perth High School pupils in the chambers at Learning Finnish. Who knew? As part of the developing young workforce efforts to look at skills surrounding tourism. And I think it's all of that stuff that goes on that is never reported in the local press that we would really hope that you would start really just not just sending out newsletters, but really shouting it from the rooftops about the good work. You're also going to have the challenge of a new build to go through, and I dare say the phone number of Mrs. Smith next to you might be a useful thing to have, because that will be an additional challenge, and also the changes that Bertha Park will bring with the change to the school community. So I don't think it's going to ease up anytime soon, but certainly the very positive performance of your senior management team at the public meeting, I would really ask that you took that back. It certainly reflected very, very well on them as a team, and the way that they conducted themselves, and a very open answering of the questions of the parents was much appreciated. So thank you very much, and we'll look forward to seeing you soon. Mrs. Smith and Mrs. Knox, you've sat very patiently through previous. Thank you very much. So that brings us on to Kinross Primary School and Nursery, and I'll ask Sharon to introduce the report.
Thank you. So this is the last, but certainly not the least, of our school reports for this committee. Kinross Primary School and Nursery class was inspected in October 2018 by Education Scotland. It was a full inspection model. And the evaluations are contained in page 24 of the report, and all quality indicators were assessed as very good for both the nursery and the primary school. It should be noted that aspects of very good practice were also highlighted by Education Scotland, not just during the inspection but prior to the inspection, in terms of Kinross Primary School's work on digital skills and also developing the young workforce. Education Scotland has asked the school to be involved in developing a sketch note which is to be shared nationally, and I'm sure that Gillian Knox, Quality Improvement Officer, and Mrs. Smith will be able to talk a bit more about that. The school have also just recently gained a place as finalist in the Scottish Education Awards this year for their digital developments too. So I'm delighted to say that Pauline Smith, head teacher, is here, along with the very new Quality Improvement Officer for the school, Gillian Knox, who joined us in January, so wasn't available when the inspection took place. That was Mark Neal, who was the Quality Improvement Officer at that time in October. However, is here and has been working with the school since January. So I'm ask Gillian to provide an overview of the report and then for Mrs. Smith to talk through the actions taken by the school since the inspection.
Thank you, good morning. Kinross Primary School is a large primary with 470 children from primary 1 to primary 7 and a nursery that caters for 120 children from 2 to 5 years of age. The inspection team found the following strengths within the school's work. Children who are courteous and respectful, are eager to learn and who talk confidently about their learning. High levels of children's attainment in literacy and numeracy. The head teacher and deputies who provide strong and supportive leadership. Together with the whole staff team, they create a positive and inclusive ethos. Highly effective partnership working, which provides children with significant skills for life, learning and work. Of particular note is the cultural group, which is led by parents, to increase the children's cultural experiences. A carefully planned learning environment in the nursery class, which enables children to participate in exciting and stimulating learning contexts. Mrs. Smith will now go on to share with you the next steps and her plans for the next phase of school improvement.
Morning, everyone. There were two areas for improvement that were identified through our report. From our point of view, we were pleased that these were things that were actually we had identified ourselves previously. And for both of those areas for improvement, they were continuing on our already clear plans for improvement. So the first one was to continue to develop the curriculum to ensure children benefit from clearer progression pathways across their learning. Over the last few years, we've developed learning pathways in numeracy, writing, digital technologies, PE, expressive arts, and for 1+2. For next year's school improvement plan, the areas that will be focused on developing learning pathways across some of the other subjects, including social subjects, RME, and other aspects of literacy. We aim to do this by collaborating with other schools, both within and out with Perth and Kinross Council, creating implementation plans and providing staff with the support and the time to create these collegiately. Over the last few years, our staff have been really clear that progress within our school is done on a basis of giving them the power to lead improvements. We've had TLCs, teacher learning communities, which were established a few years ago when we were part of the Tapestry project. Staff really like that collaborative approach to improvement, and they have asked to continue to do that over the last few years. So we have had TLCs looking at growth mindset this year. We're looking at play across the school, not just in the early years, developing play for learning, but also looking at self-regulation, which is a key priority for us and has been for a number of years. The other aspect for improvement was to continue to develop approaches to planning, assessment and tracking. The team from Education Scotland believed that we had very robust approaches, but that perhaps they could be streamlined. So our processes for planning, assessment and tracking have evolved over a number of years to ensure we've got a really full picture of the learning and the attainment across our nursery and our school. These procedures have been reviewed regularly with staff and have become really more useful, I would say, for quality assurance and for future planning over time. In terms of planning, as one of the action points, the senior leadership team have started to look at how we're planning across the school to see if we can streamline that to make it more effective for staff. Once we have come up with a process, we will then share that with staff and take feedback on that to look to start a new planning regime for next year. In terms of assessment, we'd already started looking at holistic assessments, and particularly for numeracy this year, Education Scotland were keen that we looked at holistic assessments across other aspects of the curriculum going forward. So that's something that we'll review the numeracy ones from this year, take feedback from staff, and then plan next year around their feedback. In terms of tracking, we already track 3 times annually with all staff, to including nursery staff, to review progress for cohorts of children, individual children and whole class. Moving forward, again, we'll have to look at, they would like us to streamline that. I think they think we probably track too much in terms of, we've got probably too much information. So in terms of feeding down exactly what it is we want to find out and to focus just on those areas of tracking. We will continue to review those approaches with a view to streamline further, taking account of national and local advice and support in that aspect as well. In terms of raising the bar, at Kinross we're very ambitious for our children and for all of our children. And as a team, we're a very positive team in terms of our staff group, of very positive ethos with our children. We work really collaboratively with our parents and our carers and indeed our local community. So in terms of raising the bar, we're going to continue to provide high quality, relevant learning opportunities throughout our school. We'll also continue to engage with research and national guidance, moderate our standards and expectations with each other and with other schools, both within and out with Perth and Kinross. And the focus for that is to ensure that we're continuing to add value to the lives of our learners.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Smith. It's definitely evidence of sort of Team Kinross Primary. And I know my experience of visiting the school, that's very much come across. I can also vouch for the young people being able to talk confidently about their learning, having just about had to pull myself away from the young people that were showing me around on the day that the new school opened. They were certainly extremely enthusiastic, and it's really good to hear you're talking about the staff and the eagerness of the staff to lead on improvement within the school. And we're certainly beginning to expect very high things from the Kinross cluster anytime we've had people in front of us building on Portmoke and now yourself. So thank you very much for all you do. I'll go straight to, I think, Councillor Purvis, who I dare say will have comments and questions.
I think the first comment just to say is that clearly this is a very good report, I know that from speaking to parents and people in the wider community, and as being a former pupil myself, that it's very much valued the place that Kinross has in the community and the excellent learning and teaching that's on offer at the school. I suppose just to probe a little bit further on some of the things going forward, I suppose it's just a very, very few points of improvement there. But just in terms of, you spoke about the planning and assessment and the tracking. I suppose my question would be, what if we're still working on my question while Caroline is jumping straight to me, but
we can come back.
You want to come back?
Yep.
Come back to it. Okay.
Councillor McDade.
Firstly, to say, absolutely excellent report. Reads outstanding. Looking at the feedback, it was very hard to, underlying indicators, very hard to find ones where there was really disagreement or anything. I did find a few, so I'll probe those, and a very small numbers generally. So there was one issue that what did come out was 24% of staff disagreed around effective communication. So is there... give us a bit of feedback about what you're doing on that.
Yeah, we have 50 staff in our school, so not small, not insignificant. And I think communication in a big school is always a bit of a challenge. I think, hand on heart, we try to communicate as best we can across the school in terms of if there are key issues that need to be fed out to staff, then we're very good at getting out. But sometimes, particularly with support staff, probably we've agreed that there are probably improvements to be made there. So in terms of, we now have a support staff meeting weekly with a member of the senior leadership team and also the pupil support teacher. So that has, in terms of their feedback, said that they're feeling a lot more confident about knowing perhaps key points about individual children or things that we've developed across the school.
Thank you. I think that's very positive, and I think simple things like that can often just be what staff want, and it's almost a sort of placebo effect of they feel better just because it's there. So I think that's very positive. The other thing that I did sort of pick up on were around the children's questions, and it was around 14% of the children felt that the homework didn't actually necessarily help the learning. Now obviously children might usually not think that homework, although 60% did say did help, but I think that was one of the bigger numbers that I could pull out of that one. And the other one was around pupil behaviour, and only 6% of children felt that their peers behaved, 6% of their peers behaved all the time sort of thing. So, I think that was the other numbers I could pull out of there. But, it was a very, very positive report all the way through. The numbers were all in the right columns. So I think we've got to be commended around that. But if you could give us a wee bit of feedback on those two things.
Yeah, as far as homework's concerned, Education Scotland were very keen that we developed further our wellbeing homework that we've established a few years ago, which was a takeaway homework. It was more of a home learning approach in terms of family learning, so encouraging the homework to be tasks that were done as a family as opposed to individual learning tasks. So that's something that we'll look to expand on next year as part of our school improvement plan. Children don't always appreciate the homework that they're given, sadly. So perhaps there's a bit of work to be done there in just ensuring that they know the purpose of their homework and actually the impact that completing their homework will have on a positive approach in school.
No, thank you very much. And I think it is an absolutely excellent report. And
thank you.
You should feel very proud of your school and your staff.
I am.
Councillor Rebick and I just had a bit of an eye contact moment about homework, not from us, but from our various children. So we might take Mrs Smith home to do a bit of work on that front. Councillor Rebick.
I'm quite happy to report that 100% of my children don't always agree that homework's necessary, although that is a small sample size of two, to be fair. But what I was going to say, and a sort of slightly more serious note, was that over the last couple of years, I've read a lot of these reports, and I started reading this one, and as you say, Gillian, the first two sentences were that children who are courteous and respectful are eager to learn and who talk confidently about their learning and who have high levels of children's attainment and literacy and numeracy. And I know education is not quite as simple as that, but I kind of stopped really paying that much attention after that, because that says it all, really. There's not much to not like in there. So as not as close to it as Councillor Purvis is, but I was down at the official opening, and it's clear that those assertions are true, having met not as many of the kids as you did, Caroline, but enough to know that is very much the case. The inspectors didn't mention the really good school song you've got either, which is very engaging. So just to, without being glib or patronising, just to accept my commendation for your hard work and stuff.
Thank you very much.
Councillor Wilson, and then we'll come back to Councillor Purvis.
Thank you. I'm asking these one or two points, a couple of questions and a couple of comments, in the context that there's nearly 600 bairns in this building, right, and 50 staff. That's bigger than a lot of the secondary schools in Scotland. We need to realise that places like Oak Bank and Kinross, their primaries are big, and that implies a lot in terms of communication and just keeping everybody on board. If there were questions on homework, we maybe ask the elected members, that we'd maybe get some interesting answers, because we end up with a fair lot of homework that we take home. Were you disappointed you didn't get an excellent?
Yes.
No. I asked that in the purpose that sometimes when you read some of the detail, which obviously Councillor McDade's been into in even more forensic detail than the rest of us, but if you read the report, you think, this is going to lead to an excellent, and you just don't quite get that at the end. So I share that situation with you. My second question is about the building. Now, buildings can hold you back or they can push you forward. Having a new building that was, I
think, designed for curriculum for excellence, etc. How much do you think that contributes to helping? It's not the reason you're doing well, but contributes to you doing well.
I think the building is amazing. I'd like to think that if Education Scotland had visited us in our previous building, that the quality indicator grades would have been exactly the same, because I think the children, they love their building, they're very proud of their new school, but they were equally very proud of their old building. And I think sometimes we overestimate actually what children think is the most important thing about what, when they come through the doors in the morning. And it's not really about the walls and the state of the building, it's more about the relationships that happen inside the school. And I think if you build positive relationships between your staff team, your pupils and your parents and your carers and your community, then the environment is just the environment. It certainly adds to it, and I'm not going to downcry the fact that we have got a beautiful new building, but I don't think that it's added value. I think it just is just great to have.
Thanks for that. My final comment, more than anything else, and that is, when you see the areas for improvement begin with the words "continue to" and "as planned," I think that's, you think, yes, that's good. So well done on that. And you mentioned raising the bar. In some ways, you've established the bar. Thank you.
Councillor Purvis.
Right, we'll try this again. Okay, so the first question, we spoke about leadership of a change in the staff were wanting to drive that forward. Are there any examples that you can give of where, obviously not senior leadership team, but ordinary class teachers or other people working in the school have had opportunities to do that?
Yeah, as part of our TLCs this year, focusing on play and on self-regulation, they're both led by staff. Senior leadership team have an overview of what the planned learning will be, but actually essentially both of those aspects are led by teaching staff, and in some cases ECPs from the nursery are leading some of the work on play. So the self-regulation team is being led by one ECP, the primary one teacher and a primary seven teacher, and the work on play is developed by ECP and the nursery teacher and a P6 teacher. So I think staff really value when it's led by one of their team. I think the approach collegiately, they see it as more value because people are actually walking the walk and talking the talk through the learning. And there are planned activities for each TLC that they then feed back to and work as a group to work through any problems and develop next steps. At the end of each year, they share the learning that they've had through their TLCs, and that's shared with the whole staff group. And I think it's a really positive approach to empowering staff and also to leading improvements across your school.
And on that note, obviously there are some things for which it would be less appropriate than others, but in terms of the pupil engagement and pupil voice in that change as well, are there any examples where that has been particularly well used?
Yeah, we've got a number of leadership groups across the school, including digital leaders, World of Work group. Recently the World of Work group had a careers fair, when I grow up fair in the school, where we invited local businesses and in to talk about their careers. The children planned that, they set up the hall for it, they planned the whole event, they sent out the invites, they sent out the thank you cards afterwards, and then they've invited these community partners back in for a business breakfast in term four. So there's lots of pupil voice. We've got very articulate children in our school, and we need to make sure that we are really giving them an enhanced experience so that they're able to contribute to the school and see that they have, that it is their school and that they're moving the school forward. And they absolutely do feel that without a doubt.
You mentioned digital there, and obviously mm-hmm. Mr. Johnson raised earlier about the sketch note that Education Scotland had asked for,
yeah.
And said that perhaps you might give some more detail on that. So,
yeah, I was contacted by Louise Gordon, Education Scotland, who was formerly head teacher at Portmoke, who asked if we would be interested in creating a sketch note, because our inspection report really details the consistency across the nursery and the school. She was interested in capturing how we had developed leadership of change across the nursery and the mainstream primary 1 to 3, 1 to 7. So the sketch note will, I think, focus on leadership of change, but also on the consistency in terms of the gradings as well.
Might be a useful thing for us to have sight of once it's prepared, because it's an area that I think all of us as elected members have an interest in and perhaps limited understanding of. So something like that would be helpful for us to see as well. Any further comments?
But just the last thing to say is obviously we had the public meeting, which was quite well attended from parents, and that was very good for to have an overview of the points from the report, and that was certainly very well received by those who attended it that as well. So thank you for that.
Any further comments, questions? No. Thank you both very much. And if you could pass on thanks to, I know Mark Neal had previously been QIO before he moved on. Mark had a pretty good a good track record of delivering with the head teachers, and it is very much appreciated. And that very much that team Kinross Primary approach is very, very noticeable when you go into the school, and you know, communications with parents as well. That comes across very strongly. So keep up the very, very good work, and aiming for that excellent, I suppose, as part of a team. So please take back our best wishes and thanks to everyone involved. Thank you. And that brings us on to item 4, Methven Primary School. Is that on to Sharon and Ben?
Thank you, convener. So that's the school reports that we've just been through in some detail, but as is our practice at this committee, the number of inspections and many unannounced inspections that are undertaken by the Care Inspectorate of Daycare Services means that we don't invite the head teachers or the managers of our settings to come along to this committee. Since the last committee, there were 22 inspections of daycare services that were published by the Care Inspectorate. Of these today, four are presented here as exceptions, and they come here either because of weak evaluations or excellent evaluations. All four for this committee are here because of excellent evaluations. And I suppose of note that the range of services that have been awarded as excellent for this committee covers a wide range of our services. It covers a nursery class, a playgroup, a private provider, and an out-of-school care club. So it provides a good overview of our daycare services across the early year settings we work with. If committee would wish, I would ask that Ben Scott, our service manager for early years, can give us just a brief overview of all four, or if you'd like to take them one by one, we'd be happy to do it either way.
An overview? Yes, everyone happy with that?
Overview of all four, Ben.
I'm pleased to be able to say good morning to you, because I wasn't really very sure if that was going to be possible or not. So the first report that I have to just give a quick overview and a bit of history to is Methven Primary School Nursery Class. This inspection took place by the Care Inspectorate in October 2018, and I'm pleased to be able to report that the quality indicator for care and support was graded as excellent. Methven Primary School opened in 2015, and at that point we were able to appoint a really strong team there, and they have been consistent since that time. Early year support teachers have worked really closely with them in terms of their layout and the provision and the environment, and I'm really pleased to report that in the report some of the training by the early years team has actually been noted. Play and pedals gets a mention in there. And family learning also gets a mention in there, which was taken forward with support from the early years team in terms of closing the communication gap. Within the report itself, it's lovely to read the warm, welcoming ethos, the fact that the staff are very responsive to the children's needs, and that the young people themselves are clearly leaders. They talk about an inclusive approach that they have there, and that family learning is a very strong has a very strong position within the setting. And I'm happy to take any questions about that if you wish. I'll move on.
Any questions? No.
I'm going to ask if we can have the words of the bonjour song.
That could be arranged for a later date. We could attempt,
not now, but we could attempt singing it perhaps. But no, I think it's very, very positive. Thank you.
Thank you.
In Bridgeverne is Bridgeverne Nursery. It operates out of a community hall, and practitioners actually set up and clear up on a daily basis. And the fact that they have been able to achieve an excellent for care and support, and actually the last time they had an inspection, the quality indicator management and leadership was also given a 6, and they've been able to hold on to that too. So this is a really important piece of work, actually, because that doesn't happen very regularly. They talked about happy and confident children, again being very responsive to children's needs, where children have a voice in terms of the learning experiences that are there. They also talked about excellent engagement in with families, so these are themes that are coming through all of these reports. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Sorry, it's in no way a question, but just a comment. This is an old-fashioned village hall.
Yes,
it's called the Institute.
Yes.
I've happy memories of being in it for many years, but it just reflects the situation that the head teacher at Kinross mentioned. You can do good things in a bad building, it's not a bad building. It's actually quite a good building. It's an old-fashioned, yes. Traditional building. So I think there's special credit to folk for achieving that in what is not a purpose design place at all, and setting up and clearing up afterwards is an extra challenge. So yes. I think they deserve a wee bit well done just for that alone.
It's a very strong team who really focus on nurturing relationships there in amongst the setting up and clearing up. We then had Oakbank Kids Club who were inspected in January 2019, and it's important to note that they're a long-established kids club, but they were also part of the move to the new school, and they themselves would say that they felt really involved in that process and were able to influence where they currently use in Oakbank, the storage facilities and the resources that they had, and I believe that that's part and parcel of why they've been able to achieve their excellent grade for care and support. Environment. But at the last one, they actually had care and support too, so they now have two excellent gradings, which is really very good. Again, similar themes coming through in terms of the text, extremely caring and nurturing staff, relationships with the children are key. They talked about active play and the play being freely chosen by young people, and that's probably because it's an after-school club. But that also staff were really keen to listen to and respect the views and involve them in their planning too. So again, similar themes coming through to be able to achieve that excellent grading.
I would just comment that Councillor Wilson, Councillor Lyle and myself all had a thoroughly good afternoon, and we could barely get the provost out of the place because we wanted to stay. And I think the absolute delight of the staff at achieving those gradings was very evident, and there's a comment here about the girls at Oakbank are great, and I think that probably pretty much sums it up. But the girls are at various assorted ages from what we could work out, but very, very positive service.
And finally, it's Honey Pot Almond Bank, which is one of our partner providers, and they were inspected in January 2019. They also had received a 6 at their last inspection, and so they are now sitting with two excellence. Within the text, it talks about a secure, nurturing environment, and that staff are committed at all times to the health and well-being of children, and that children are able to develop and grow at their own pace. So again, that children being involved in their learning and relationships is coming through. But interestingly, in terms of Honeypot Almond Bank, the manager there is very inspirational, and she has a real love of learning herself, and that then inspires her team to undertake study and research to ensure that they have quality learning environment for the children. They received an award last year for being the best team
the quality of their staffing, and they've entered into it again this year in terms of their environment, so we're hoping that they can be successful in that regard too.
Just a comment that's not, as always, often prefix it with, it's not meant to be glib or patronising, but I think the four that we've had today are really excellent, so it's important that this subcommittee recognises the people involved in that, and if you can pass on our thanks, that'd be really appreciated. But I think the broader point is that I think Perth and Kinross generally were in a good place as we march towards earlier childcare expansion, and the fact that we have not just these four but many assets in terms of nurseries both within the schools and our partner providers, I think stands us in good stead, which is not to be complacent. I know there's a lot of work to be done in that, but I think it is important that we start from a good place, and that's so thank you for that.
I think it's absolutely right, and the kind of unsung team behind a lot of the work, the early years team, who do a huge amount of behind the scenes stuff, you know, working with parents to look at where there hasn't been provision. So I'm thinking about up in Pitlochry, and various other communities. You know, a lot of behind the scenes stuff that goes on working alongside the partner providers and our own services as well. And if you take that back to your team, Ben,
thank you for those comments.
I think if I can just add, sorry, without wanting to start boring anybody, but I think it's no coincidence that when you look at a lot of the initial reports that have very good and excellence, often that for Kinross, for example, it then leads into the primary being very good and excellent. I don't think that's any coincidence. I think we're well aware these days that education starts actually at minus 9 months these days and not in primary one.
Any further comments? Councillor McDade?
Yeah, and just following on from Councillor Rebeck's point, and I think you know, just to recognise that we do have outstanding, looking back at the list of you know, past couple of years of reports, we have consistently got a very strong sector there in, I mean, just a cross section, as you said, and obviously the registration requirements, etc., can be quite onerous for some of these groups, you know, the kids clubs, etc. And I think it's quite incredible that they've managed to get those fives and sixes, those very goods and excellence, and do all of the other parts of it, and you know, not necessarily be, you know, through a kids club, or you know, that's really a lot of work that they're putting in to get both the you know, registration, maintain all of that, and get that fantastic standard. And I think that is a real testament to the work that they're doing. I think it's Rebecca's point about you know, that does then follow through is quite, you know, correct. You can see that generally if they're having a really good experience at the nursery, and it follows on, and it's also a love of learning, basically. So I think that's something we should, you know, not lose sight of.
Thank you, Ben. Which takes us on to Appendix 8. If there's any comments on the stats?
So Appendix 8 is the overall performance in terms of the quality indicators. And we've also got three teams working within early years who have been distinct and separate. Over the last year, I would have to commend Ben, the service manager, who's been working really hard to bring those teams together to make sure that the expansion of early learning and childcare is much more seamless. So where we're thinking about kids clubs and 1140 hours, those teams have been working quite separately, but we're working really hard to make sure that those teams combine and work together to ensure that we will continue through quite a challenging period over the next year or 18 months to make sure that we continue this progress. And it is a watching brief. We're well aware that there are risks attached to this, but I'm happy to hear the commendation from committee about the progress to date. Thank you.
Any comments? No. I think it's really clearly laid out. It's a very helpful format in allowing us to see sort of progress and where we are and where we hope, where we need to get to. So I guess on behalf of the committee, I think based on all of our comments today, I think we recognise that the heart of all of this is our staff, and right across from, you know, people that work with very young children right through to, you know, those that are just heading out at S6, that we are blessed in Perth and Kinross with a really committed team of staff right through the council, but that we can't get complacent, and we need to, you know, I was very struck by the questioning from the parents at the Perth High School meeting about them wanting to know how they would know that things were improving. And, you know, it comes back to that, how we make sure that it's very clear through the statistical evidence of progress, that's something we're determined to keep working to. So if you can take back to the staff within your service how much we appreciate everything they do, that would be very helpful. So I think we've just skipped into the afternoon, but bring the meeting to a close. Thank you very much.